Okay, thank you very much, Bernard, and good morning to everyone. So indeed, I'm going to talk about another resource that was not picked by the previous panelists, in fact, which is space, and in fact, the use of the lunar orbits, and how we can use them in a way that is sustainable for the future lunar robotic and human exploration. But before I do that, I wanted to acknowledge a few colleagues who have participated to the preparation of this session. So my colleague Sergio Ventura from the Independent Safety Office at ESA's Tech, Diane Davis from the NASA Johnson Space Center. Diane is the mission design lead for the Gateway at NASA. Professor Stéphanie Lizy-Lestré, who is somewhere in the room, who has been co-managing this working group and who will be later in the panel discussion. And Paolo Guardabosso, who is a PhD candidate at SuperAero. So why do we care about the management of lunar orbits? I will be very quick on this slide that was already presented yesterday by Francis Rocard. I think the message is very clear. So today we have only indeed a handful of orbits of operational missions at the moon, but the situation is about to change drastically in the next decade. So we have orbiter, lander, rover missions from all major space agencies, and also from a lot of new commercial endeavors that will go back to the moon in the next decade. And there are prospects for up to 250, according to this market research from Northern Sky Research, that will eventually go back in the next 10 years. So indeed, the question is, how do we make sure that we will preserve the space around the moon, in the vicinity of the moon? And it starts with the management of the lunar orbits. So what are we talking about? So on this chart, I've illustrated a few of lunar and cislunar orbits that exist. In fact, there is a large and very rich diversity of orbits that exist in the Earth-Moon system in any three-body problem or four-body problem. But these ones are in particular very interesting for different applications that we will have the opportunity to discuss. So I don't know if it's very visible at the very closer point of the surface. We have the family of low lunar orbits that we will discuss a bit later. If we increase a bit the altitude, we are seeing some elliptical lunar orbits, a family of which is the elliptical lunar frozen orbit that we will also briefly discuss. Going a bit even higher now, we have the yellow big one here is the near rectilinear halo orbit. This is the orbit that will be the baseline for the Gateway that has been presented already a few times during the conference. And part of the same family, we have also the Earth-Moon Lagrange point orbit. So I've shown one example here in red. So it's a relatively small amplitude halo orbit around the L2 point, EML2 point, which is actually the orbit that's being used today by the Chinese relay orbiter Chechao for communications with the far side of the moon. And finally, we'll discuss also a little bit later, so a large family of so-called distant retrograde orbits that looked a bit like traditional orbits around the moon, but these are also very much three-body problem orbits with interesting properties. So I think this is the main message when we talk about orbits around the moon. This is a complex dynamics environment. They are all subject to a lot of orbital perturbation from the Earth's gravity field, from the sun, from other planets to a lesser extent. Something that is also very specific to the moon is the gravity field of the moon itself. So although the moon is very spherical in shape, and you see actually, in fact, according to the IAU constant parameters, the equatorial radius and the polar radius are the same. What is very specific is what is happening below the surface somehow, and which results in this very irregular gravity field of the moon. So now today we have very detailed gravitational models of the moon, in particular from the GRAIL mission, no, with this spherical expansion coefficients up to order very, very large orders in degrees. And so we are able to explain the impacts of this gravity field, which is very spectacular, especially on the low lunar orbits that we will discuss now. But why low lunar orbits, first of all? So just to say a quick word about why these are interesting for space mission design. So obviously, because they are low, they are close to the lunar surface, and this presents some obvious advantages for lunar science, huh? For remote sensing application, also communication with the surface. They are also useful, the staging orbits, if you want, for crewed mission as an intermediary orbit for landers and ascenders going back to the surface of the moon. And as part of the families of low lunar orbits, the polar low lunar orbits are particularly interesting because they are polar and therefore they are covering the pole, and in particular the South Pole, which is of very high interest as we've seen many times today. They are also slightly more easily reachable from an orbital transfer perspective than, for example, the equatorial orbits for thanks to a biplane targeting maneuver, but I won't go into too much detail here. So we are thinking one peculiarity of these low lunar orbits, and it's been experienced and for the first time in the Apollo program. So these are extremely unstable. And what you see on this slide is just the effects of the gravity field that we've described before. It's nothing to do with drag, obviously, at the moon. There is no such thing at 100 kilometer altitude. It's really the effect of these lunar mass cons, so this mass concentration resulting in this very irregular gravity field. And you see the evolution of a sample polar low lunar orbit, 100 kilometer altitude initially, and the evolution of the aposthelene altitude and the periselene altitude here, which in about 6 months, it is a standard order of magnitude of the lifetime of such orbits, will naturally decay and impact the surface of the moon. So this is indeed a very, very peculiar property, quite unique, I think, in the solar system. On the right side, another peculiarity, in fact, if you vary the initial plane angle, so this right ascension of the ascending node, what is striking to see is that all of these orbits will also, at least the polar low lunar orbits, will actually eventually reach a point on the surface that is in a very narrow, limited latitude band within minus 50, minus 30 degrees in the southern hemisphere. So this is also a very peculiar behavior of these orbits that we see that naturally they will decay with this behavior. Now if we go a bit higher in altitude, so this gravity field and this perturbation will become less important, but progressively the Earth's gravity field will become the dominant perturbation. And so I mentioned it before, so we can still manage this perturbation by the orbit design, and there is a family of so-called elliptical lunar frozen orbits. There are different design possible, different orbital periods. I show here an example with the 24 hours orbit period on the right. This is particularly interesting for something that's been mentioned by Stéphane Demey before, which is the Moonlight, ESA Moonlight program, and basically to put around the moon a constellation of spacecraft for communication and navigation services. So this is indeed the ESA Moonlight program with the Lunar Pathfinder, which will be the technology demonstration flying in 2025. And later on, indeed, the deployment of this constellation, this Lunar Communication and Navigation Service, which very important as well when we speak about sustainable use of lunar space, will be interoperable with future missions serving the same purpose at the moon, in particular NASA future constellations, via this LunaNet framework. Now, the Gateway orbit. So we've heard about the Gateway a few times indeed. So the Gateway will find a very peculiar orbit as well, which is called a near rectilinear halo orbit. So it's part actually of the large family of three-body problem orbits, the halo orbits around the vicinity of L2 points. It's not too much close to L2 in the end. You see it's this one in blue here towards the left, as seen in the Earth-Moon rotating frame. And so it looks very much like an orbit around the moon, but it's very much indeed a three-body problem orbit, part of the halo family. So I've just showing the properties of this orbit. It's a 9-2 resonant orbit, completing 9 revolutions in 2 months, 2 lunar months. It has been extensively trade off for the purpose of the Gateway against other orbit candidate design. But it has indeed some interesting properties when we speak about dynamical effects that are relevant for the discussion today. So this is indeed the departure dynamics and the disposal options from this NRHO orbit. So what is particularly striking there is that with a very limited amount of fuel, of delta V, you can end up in very different places. So these are sometimes described as stable orbits because they are more stable than a lot of these Lagrange point orbits, but still they are still very chaotic in a way, so that a small perturbation and small maneuver will make them depart towards different places. And one of these places is heliocentric space. So with only a few meters per second, about 3 meters per second, you start to have trajectories that will escape towards heliocentric orbit, escaping either via the Sun-Earth L1 region or here towards the right, the L2 regions. Some of them would remain bounded, of course, in the Earth-Moon system, at least for some time, potentially eventually escape or impact the moon. but a lot of them will potentially escape to deep space. And some others will impact the surface of the moon. So there has been an extensive study by some colleagues and also in NASA to assess the possible reachable locations for different position of the maneuvers, magnitude, direction, location on the orbit, and so on, to see what are the impact locations on the surface of the moon that are accessible for a given amount of fuel or delta V. And you see some of the results here. It's just a snapshot of a much wider analysis that's been performed by some colleagues, including Diane Davis and also Paolo Guardabasso. I will not describe this table on the left here because it's going to be described in more detail, I think, by Stephanie later in the panel. Just to wrap up, indeed, about the topic of disposal. So what are the options for disposing of missions around the moon? There are four options. So we talked about already about the lunar impacts, and we provide a few recommendations in the final slide later. And we talked about the heliocentric disposal, so disposing into an orbit around the sun, which has some potential concerns that, in fact, this spacecraft left into heliocentric space might, and eventually will have periodic returns to the Earth-Moon vicinity. So generally, when designing mission, we make sure that this doesn't happen in the next 100 years, but it's still something that that will eventually remains as a possibility. Two other options, so Earth re-entry. I mean, it's been described in a previous talk as well. Artemis 1 indeed went back to the Earth and splashed down in, after an atmospheric re-entry. And cislunar graveyard. So like the Earth, we can have some orbits in the lunar vicinity that can be used for long-term disposal of the missions. So just a couple of recommendations, potential recommendations for what could become space debris mitigation guidelines. So one concern for lunar impacts, in fact, is the preservation of the sites on the surface, obviously. So there are some sites that we want to avoid, either for heritage historic reason or for scientific reasons. And so an idea would be to dedicate some regions on the surface to a so-called landfill concept. And I put one illustration here where regions have been identified as potential candidate landfills for disposing of spacecraft. With, of course, respecting preliminary planetary protection guidelines, the poles, polar regions are of high scientific interest, so they cannot be there. But these are mid-latitude regions that could be accessible either actively by active maneuvers or passively, as we've seen, thanks to the perturbation at the moon. And for long-term graveyard orbits, so there is a particular candidate, which is this distant retrograde orbit family we've seen in the first slide. So as you see again here, each color is one orbit, so it's a large family of candidate orbits that appears to emanate from the moon, but going to much larger amplitude. And it has been shown that there is a subset of these orbits, amplitude between 60,000, 68,000 kilometers, have been found to be very long-term stable. So analysis up to more than 500 years of propagation, including all the relevant perturbations, have shown that we are never coming back to the Earth to impacting the moon and so on. So these are really good candidate options as well for long-term disposal of lunar missions. So one final slide with some bullet points of summary. I will not read everything, but just to say that, in fact, indeed, space debris today is not an issue at the moon. But as was said as well by Jean-Jacques Dordain at the beginning, maybe we should learn from our experience at the Earth and in Earth's orbit to avoid it ever becomes an issue in the future. So the disposal into predictable and safe trajectories is one of these recommendations. I will just say that, in fact, indeed, at ESA, we have recently completed the zero debris concurrent design facility study with new recommendations for the future of space debris mitigation. And there is a new standard in preparation which will incorporate the new concept of these valuable orbits. And some of these lunar orbits that we talked about could be part of these new valuable orbits. So I've listed a few areas for future studies in terms of orbits, which I'm not going to describe, a few additional recommendations, which I'm not going to describe either, because they will be also tackled by Michel later on. And so I thank you very much for your attention, and leave the floor for Alexis Payet for the next talk.